By the turn of the 20th century, Gloucester fishermen were still hooking bottom fish from dories set out from sailing schooners. By the time of Gloucester's 300th anniversary in 1923, this had all changed. By then, captains routinely installed heavy-duty, slow-turning diesel engines on their vessels, making obsolete much of the equipment required in the wind-powered era. The size and shape of fishing vessels quickly evolved to accommodate the more efficient process by which fish were captured.
The advantages of a diesel engine, it gives the control of the vessel to the men that are working on the platform. These were side trawlers at the time, and that net was hoisted and retrieved by the vessel's crew through the aid of a winch.
Engines provided so much more than propulsion. They powered winches that could haul tons of net-captured fish on board in minutes. This resulted in the rapid and universal acceptance of the dragnet or outer trawl method of harvesting fish. The invention of Clarence Birdseye's flash freezing process revolutionized the handling and packaging of fish. Large refrigerated warehouses substantially increased our storage capacity, freeing up the waterfront acreage previously utilized by the flake yards, the salt fish drying method which had been a feature of our waterfront since colonial times.
The Portuguese people discovered a little fish, a redfish, as an incidental catch to their dory trawling in the early 30s. In the daytime, the redfish were on the bottom of the ocean, traveling in schools. The dory trawling method could not catch this fish in volume. They were too small. They couldn't take the bait and so forth. But with the adoption of the dragging method, the outer trawl method, and the net, we were now capable of catching this fish in volume. One of the premier captains in that era was Captain Matthew Sears, a Portuguese man who was a highliner, a phenomenal fisherman. He caught so many fish so fast, he did not even use ice to preserve the fish. Of course, the fishing grounds were close by, but he did so well that Ben Pine, in 1942, invested in a super dragger, again named the Columbia, his favorite of all vessels. 100 foot long, 24 foot wide, had a powerful 350 horsepower Cooper Bessemer heavy duty engine, the best of equipment. And with Matthew Sears and his seasoned crew, they went aboard the brand new Columbia, and in 9 months, the Columbia was paid for, and the crew shared $15,000 a man for 9 months of work on the Columbia. It made headlines in the Gloucester Daily Times, and it was all through the catching of redfish. World War II was about to become a part of our life in Gloucester. This seaport town was very apprehensive about what was going on. German submarines were reported to be frequenting the Atlantic coast and coming in looking for fuel and so forth from the American vessels that were fishing. We had two vessels, the Aeolus, Captain John O. Johnson, a schooner boat, and the Ben and Josephine, Captain Joe Shementaro. These two vessels were in the Gulf of Maine fishing when a German submarine surfaced. First they boarded the Ben and Josephine, ordered the crews off the vessel, and then they shelled the vessel and sunk it. From there, they went to the Aeolus, boarded the vessel, pumped the diesel fuel out, robbed the vessel of its food and supplies, threatened the men. They had to go off in the dory, and the German submarine stood off and sunk the Aeolus too. That was like the forewarning of things to come. Well, you know, the war was coming and we knew that. And they were already talking about rationing gas and so forth. So my dad and I took our 1938 Ford over to Wanson's Garage in East Gloucester, which is a big a barn like many Gloucester people. We put the car up in storage, put it up on blocks, and took the battery out, and that was it for the duration of the war. So anyway, we didn't have an automobile, and we're walking home from Trinity Church. We just got home probably a quarter of one, and about 1 o'clock in the afternoon, it came over the radio. The Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor. That was, I don't even remember sitting down at the table, but I'm sure we ate, but it was a terrible thing at that time. And the war started. And
most of the people, the mothers had to bring up 5 or 6 kids, for sometimes 4 years. And it took a lot for a woman to do that. And I would read the paper and find out what was happening over in France. And I just got so interested in what was happening in the war.
All the fishermen were certified as waterfront observers. Of course, the Coast Guard expanded their operations. They took over the tavern on the city of Gloucester's waterfront in the inner harbor. That was their headquarters. The Hart's Garage on the intersection of Main and Eastern Avenue was taken over for recruits and enlisted men. The Coast Guard was eyeballing our fleet of vessels as possible patrol boats on the East Coast. Well, they confiscated them. The Teresa M. Boudreau was built brand new at the Story Shipyard, and before she ever made a trip fishing, she was confiscated by the United States Navy as a patrol boat. There were many boats, probably 15 or 20 vessels, that were taken over by the United States Navy as patrol boats on our coast.
When the war came on, the government found out that the redfish would be perfect. They were purchasing most of the redfish.
I was born in Gloucester, and as a young girl, lived across the street from Harbor Terrace. And I used to love to listen to that putt-putt of the fishing boats early in the morning. And as kids, we just used to reel nets that fishermen brought in that got tangled up. And we made a little money that way, reeling nets.
Anything about a fish, you knew from bow to stern on them. And that's how we made our living, that's how we lived. And that's how I used to make a couple of bucks. I'd get on the wharf and say, "Hey, Cap, can I have a haddock?" He'd say, "Yeah, how many you want, kid?" "Couple." I take the haddock. I had a little thing we called a jigger, full of cardboard box, full of ice, threw the haddock in there and went out in front of the First National and sit there with a little sign, "Fish for sale." And somebody would come by and say, How about a half a buck, kid?" You say, "Why, you thought you hit the Klondike, the mother load. 50 cents for fish?"
I'd get on the wharf in the summertime and sell my Xyrex for 2 cents a glass. It worked out good because I made good money. And then when I was through, one of the dock workers would say, "Come over here, Joe," and he'd throw in 20 or 30 mackerel and cover it over with ice and say, "There." So then I'd take the mackerel and I'd go around the neighborhood and sell the mackerel to make more money, so.
Along about 1944, in February, as I recall, Gloucester had a real northeast snowstorm. So anyway, here I am walking through Jordan's Wharf with a shovel over my shoulder. I'm looking to buy my way into the North Shore Theater in the afternoon. It's on a Saturday right after the storm. And I hear this old man holler to me, "Hey!" Here he is, this old guy, probably 60 years old, sitting on the cabin trunk of a long, flat, wide barge-like vessel called the Wenham Lake. Well, it turns out that that's the harbor water boat. And he's calling to me to come down and shovel off his deck. So down the ladder I went onto the Wenham Lake and I shoveled off his deck. He paid me a quarter. And he said to me at the time, "If you ever want to take a ride around the harbor, come aboard anytime and I'll take you for a tour. Well, you know, I was really excited about the waterfront, but I also had my quarter. So off I went to have my lunch at home and then get down to the North Shore Theater and go to the movies. Well, a few days went by, and of course, I sought out the Wenham Lake and John Winterberg and went aboard the boat. And that, my friends, was the introduction to the waterfront. The Wenham Lake and John Winterberg put fresh potable water aboard every fishing vessel in the North Channel, from the head of the harbor all up along the eastern side over to the fish pier. There was the Portuguese fleet at the United Fisheries Wharf that numbered about 25 or 30 vessels. Jordan's Wharf had a half a dozen vessels there. We put water aboard. Gorton's vessels, there were about 15 or 20 Gorton's vessels that we put water aboard. John J. Burke, Sherman Ruth Wharf, had 35 or 40 vessels. And, of course, Ben Pine's fleet was about 8 or 10 vessels up there that we put water on. We had probably 125 vessels that we serviced with water. The Wenham Lake, 38 foot long, probably 12, 13 feet wide, had a cypress water tank that held 5,600 gallons of water. What it did when I went aboard that Wenham Lake, it introduced me to every vessel that was operating out of the North Channel. I got to know all the crews. I got to know where the keys were hidden for the forecastles. It was a position of trust. I was known as the water boy, the kid on the water boat. And another little thing I might add is that John Winterberg was as deaf as a haddock. He could not hear, absolutely could not hear. So he would holler to me, and I would holler back to him. And people would say that they could hear us going up the harbor on either side, either the fish pier or the North Channel. They knew what we were talking about because we were each yelling at each other.
The combined effect of these four events, the diesel engines, the trawling of nets, the flash freezing processing method, and the discovery of redfish, resulted in a buildup of the fishing fleet like no other period in Gloucester's history. Its culmination was the end of World War II. The vessels confiscated for patrol duty returned home. The B&M Freight Yard received weekly shipments of diesel engines from Oakland, California and Mount Vernon, Ohio. And when local shipyards became overbooked, private boatyards from Maine to Florida were taking orders for Gloucester vessels.
Around 1944, William A. Robinson's shipyard in Ipswich, Mass., launched 12 modern, architecturally designed fishing vessels for the Gloucester fishing fleet. That was just one segment. Gloucester's fleet was also increased by the number of vessels that were coming out of Maine shipyards and also from vessels that were being converted over to commercial fishing vessels in 1944, 1945, the end of the war. So, when the war ended and the men started to come back, we were ready to participate in a massive increase in the catching of fish along the eastern seaboard. It was a different era. After World War II, the men were all returning from the service. New crew members were coming back. The town was alive. There was a patriotic feeling that prevailed at the time. It was mandatory that every male member of Gloucester High School's sophomore, junior, and senior classes participated in the regimental affairs of the ROTC. I was a member of the ROTC band. It was full of enthusiasm. New homes were being built in Vista Del Mar, which is now known as Marina Drive. Riverdale Park's housing community was being built. entry-level homes for the returning veterans, and of course, the run-up to Route 128 was happening, and it was opened in 1951. So Gloucester was on the move. Millions and millions of pounds of fish were landed, and every year the landings were increasing. That was the feeling amongst the community at the time. We were all involved. The whole city was involved in fishing. There were 2,000 fishermen, there were 200 boats, there were 20 processing plants on the Gloucester waterfront that belonged to the Gloucester Fisheries Association, and every one of those employed 15 or 20 or 30 fish cutters. There were six machine shops all over the waterfront that serviced the engines on these vessels. Machinists, railways workers, net makers. You couldn't get down Main Street for fish trucks going by from one plant to another. Friday noon times at the banks were all loaded with fish workers cashing their paychecks. Everybody was involved, and it was meaningful employment. That's what we did. Each plant had their own workforce, and these people were members of the Gloucester Seafood Workers Union. Inside these plants, that's where the redfish came. They were brought up to the second floor, what they call the pen room, where these redfish were stockpiled to be sent down to the first floor where they were processed. About 15 fish cutters were on the bench, on either side of the bench. I was a pan boy, and it was my job to tend to the 15 or 20 fish cutters. And as they filled these stainless steel pans, I would weigh individually the pan and record that number. And it's this production that Joe Cadena, the boss, would pay strict attention to, because each cutter, unionized cutter, was required to cut a minimum of 120 pounds of off-the-knife fillets per hour. So once the pan was weighed, I would dump the pan in what we called a brine tank, which is the salt, freshwater salt mixture, and they would be washed, and they come up a conveyor belt onto a canling table where a dozen girls would inspect the fillets before they would go to the packing process, and girls would put them in 1-pound boxes, and they would be packaged. They would go onto a rack, and we were on the fish pier, so that rack was conveniently taken right down to the freezer and would go into the freezer, the finished product. In the run of a day, we would work from 7 o'clock in the morning to 9 o'clock at night.
Right after I got out of school, I went with my father. The skipper of the Nancy F was Scotty Parisi. All the other boats were going to pull into Booth Bay Harbor. He decided he was going to try to make it home. And we were bucking it in a bad storm. Snowstorm and just blowing a gale. And I had to go, and we had to, of course, winter, I had to go up on the rigging and lock 1 foot inside of the rigging so that we could break ice. And we had to stay, keep breaking ice, because if you don't break the ice, you're gonna tip over. The boat's gonna roll over because it gets top heavy. And I was up on the thing and I saw the shadow go by me. This is at night. The shadow went by me and I said, what was that? It was the oil tank. On the deck, the kerosene tank for the stove down on the forecastle. It just went by me. I didn't, and they said, it's gone. So it just ripped right out of the deck. When the bow went down, you were hoping to come back up quick, because many boats have been swamped. And we made it in.
Now, the Portuguese fleet not only had Captain Matthew Sears, but there were many other highliners within this fleet of vessels. Captain David Ribeiro in the Edith L. Boudreau was a highline fisherman and sword fisherman in those days. The Portuguese were sword fishing experts, and David Ribeiro was one of those. Captain Frank Rose in the Spring Chicken and the vessel called the Edith and Lillian. There was Captain Joe Rose in the converted dory trawler Laura Goulart, renamed the Carolina Mary. Joe Rose ran the mail. That's an expression for timely delivery of redfish to Gloucester's processing plants in the 1940s. There was also a Joaquin Gasper, who was an innovative pioneer in the redfishing vessel business. Many of these were the backbone of the fleet at that time in delivering redfish to Gloucester's industry. The Portuguese fishermen were primarily offshore fishermen, and they excelled in the dragging business. They were also masters at the sword fishing game. They were the primary operators of the sword fishing fleet of the 40s and 50s. I grew up in Ward 2, and with the exception of 5 years in the service, my entire life was spent in Gloucester. Ward 2 was the Portuguese neighborhood. So early on, I met my friend Manny Rocha, who came from Fair Street. And there was Bobby Quinn from Scott Street. There was Helen Silvera and Babe Goulart, my friends from the Hill, Louis Costa, Narcisse Cecilio, whose mother was a widow and operated a rooming house. They became my lifelong friends. It was their fathers that worked on the waterfront. Louis Costa's father was a fish skinner at the Slade Gardens in East Gloucester. His father stood 8 hours at the bench skinning codfish and deboning codfish. If they didn't work on the wharf, they operated the fishing vessels. They owned the vessels. And at the center of the community was Our Lady of Good Voyage Church. It provided the spiritual and the social life to these Portuguese people. In the spring of the year, the Portuguese celebrate what they call the crownings. Now that all started many years ago. Captain Joseph Mosquita was fitting out his brand new dory trawler, the Mary P. Mosquita. He had shipped 16 men when a man by the name of Alfred Brown asked if he could sail on the trip, and the vessel sailed. While she was at anchor in the dark of night, the steamship Saxonia came by and cut the Mary P. Mosquita in half. The vessel sunk in 7 minutes. All 16 men came out except for Alfred Brown. When the crew reconvened on the deck of the Saxonia, Captain Mosquita led them all in prayer, and he vowed that if his crew returned safely to Gloucester, that he would commission a crown to be made in Portugal in commemoration of the event, and that annually a crowning would be celebrated in the Portuguese church. Now, back when I was a boy, there was this crowning ceremony every spring. The Drum Corps had a crowning. The Gloucester Fraternity Club sponsored one crowning. The DES Club on Prospect Street, the Holy Name Society in the church. These are all fraternal organizations within the Lady of Good Voyage Church. They all sponsored crowning Sundays, leading up to the Portuguese blessing of the fleet. In 1948, the Portuguese hospital ship Gil Ains came to Gloucester and delivered our statue that's at the top of the Lady Good Voyage Church today. My friend Jean Ribeiro Mason was in the procession going to the state fish pier to welcome the statue. Jean is leading the parade. Her father's crew, Captain David Ribeiro's crew, is behind her as she comes down East Main Street and onto the fish pier. And it was just a festive time. I said, John, you know, I'd really like to have my own dory. I'd like to have my own boat. John said, well, go see Jeff Domingues. He's the manager of the United Fisheries. And, of course, that was the headquarters for the Portuguese fleet. Every swordfish boat had a number of dories on the wharf. So Jeff said to me, yes, I'll sell you a dory. I have a dory for you. And the cost is $10. Oh, I went down to John Winterberg on the boat. And we were tied up at the United Fisheries. And John said, I'll give you the $10 and I'll pick out a boat for you. Now, I thought, well, I'll probably get some old dory, some old beat up old dory that he wants to get rid of. That's not so. When I went down there, I got almost a brand new dory. That's what I like about the waterfront in those days. Jeff wanted to be certain that this young kid got a good boat. He wasn't about to take advantage of some young boy that didn't know too much about anything. In the waterfront, that's everything. You have to be trustworthy. You have to be a sincere person. You can't get by in this competitive business of fishing. You cannot get by if you're not sincere and trustworthy. Well, I think that goes probably in any business. Now we go to the Canadian influence on the waterfront. They were headquartered in around Gorton's Wharf on the Main Street side of the North Channel, and there were many vessels that were skippered by highline fishermen in the Gorton's fleet. Captain Jerome Noble in the schooner Corinthian, Captain Albert Williams in the Mother Ann. These men were high producers and their crews were excellent seamen. From there we went to Burke's Wharf, John J. Burke's Wharf, and most of those vessels were skippered by Nova Scotians and Canadians. Captain Lloyd Campbell and the vessel Hilda Garston, his friend and senior fisherman from the dory trawling days, Cecil Moulton, had the brand new vessel, the Florence and Lee, and Freeman Cockham, and Johnny Burnham. All of these people were excellent fishermen and all highliners. They led the fleet in producing a volume of fish that was record-setting. Up from the John J. Burke Wharf was Piney's Wharf. Piney's vessels were primarily operated by Nova Scotians and Newfoundlanders. Piney had nothing but highliners operating from his wharf. He ran what could be called a school, because as the fishermen progressed in their careers from engineer to captain, Piney would give them a chance. He was forever promoting the industry and educating fishermen to advance in the industry. In 1944, I went aboard the waterboat with John Winterberg, and soon thereafter, we were putting water aboard Ben Pine's fleet. In those days, in all vessels, the water tanks were under the forecastle floor up in the bow. So it required throwing the hose down the companionway, and just below the companionway on either side of the foremast were two little hatches that you lifted up, and that's where the water hose was inserted. Well, here I am on my knees aboard the Columbia. We're filling the water tanks, and the next thing I see this image of a man coming down the companionway. You come down a companionway, backwards, by the way, and he turned around and introduced himself, and it was Ben Pine. From the very beginning, Ben Pine was a likable person. He might have been a little gruff and a little rough around the edges, but he was an accepting person, and he admired young kids. I had a lot of interaction with Ben Pine, and we became friendly. About 1945, 46, I became almost a regular on Piney's Wharf, and I was kind of outgrowing the water boat, and Piney's Wharf was more interesting to me. There was more going on. The industry was a vibrant place, and the workers were always around the waterfront, and Chris Nielsen was up above, up aloft, in the rigging of his vessels. And Pat Coochie and Peter Shields and Austin Carter were waterfront workers for Piney. They ran the carpenter shop and made all the repairs and on the vessels in between trips. The people that were part of the Atlantic Supply in those days were almost like a fraternity.
Oh, Piney's Wharf, I lived just up in front of it. There's so much going on. And again, you'd see characters. People like Pat Coochie, who was a carpenter. If you gave him a hammer and a nail, I think he could have built Noah's Ark. I mean, clever, and all the joints and everything you'll never see that again. My father wanted some copper paint to paint the bottom of his boat. So let's go down and see Ben, see if he recommend anything. So we went, my father and Ben were talking. He had this storeroom with anything that belonged to a boat, any type of it, device, it was there. Ben had it. If you didn't have the money, that's all right. I'll see you when you got it. Come down to give me a couple of haddock. We'll square things or something like that. Ben was that type of a guy.
The Italian fleet, concentrated in Harbor Cove, was a fleet of a little bit different nature. The Italians were primarily the mackerel seiners of the era, and they supplied probably 90% of the mackerel that were landed in the 40s and 50s. They were without question the masters at mackerel fishing, seining, in those days.
Garossi shouts from the crow's nest. He sees a patch of boiling water. There they are, slashing, dancing mackerel swarming near the surface.
When I say seining, I'm talking about surface fishing without the aid of technology and the modern navigational instruments and fish finding equipment. Mackerel were caught by seine. That is a net that's cast on the surface in a huge circle around a school of fish that's sighted from a crow's nest. The mast headsman would see the school ahead of the vessel, and the vessel seine boat would go circle that school of fish and drop the seine in a circular pattern, and it would be pursed up and the fish would be trapped in the seine. Once that seine was now gathered in, or as the fishermen termed it, the twine was dried, the large vessel would come up alongside the seine. They would tie the cork line up to the side of the vessel, and with their gaff and a donkey engine, they had a huge dip net. And that dip net would be plunged into the mackerel in the seine over the side, and the donkey engine would pull that dip net out of the water and then over the vessel's hatch. The drawstring on the bottom would be released, and the fish, the mackerel, would tumble into the fish hole. But seining in those days and mackerel fishing was a surface fishing, and you could see the fish in schools on the surface of the ocean.
I started in 52, like that, three fishing in the harbor with my father and my uncle, my father's uncle. Same uncle that my father fished with when he was little in Italy. I was still in school, so it was in summer. As a matter, we were down in Rhode Island catching fish, taking them out in New Bedford. And my mother come down in the car and she says, the nuns want you to come finish school, Michael. She told me, go get you, and you wouldn't have to make up the 2 weeks you lost. And my father said, Mike, you got one more year to go. You're a senior now. Go to school. You got the rest of your life to fish. So I went back with my mother, and I finished high school. Surface fish, well, there's mackerel, but we're not after mackerel. We were after pogies. Then they're pelagics, and they're non-edible fish. And we'd sell them lobster bait for two cents a pound, $2 a tote. Now they sell for like $30 a tote. And before we'd go fishing, when the power block came in, we went from 16 to 11 men to catch a load of fish. Now we're down to four men. I used to go scouting around. I'm going to go look for tomorrow. So I'd go looking, I'd look and I'd look. And I went into Gloucester Harbor and I saw a fish. I called my father up on the phone when he come in. Dad, tomorrow you tell the boys, come down a little later. And then all the boats, they went out. They didn't see the eider going first. They went out. They're going to Boston. That's where the fish were all the time. And once they got out of the harbor, call them up. Everybody gone. Yep, okay. Got on my airplane. Come up. Start looking around. And I see the fish right outside the ice company. Loaded them up.
I can remember it like it was yesterday. My insurance partner, my friend Joe Cody, and I, it was our habit to go to the Gloucester Marine Railways every morning at 7 o'clock. We met there with Harry Cusick and so forth. We were walking down the driveway, and we noticed this little plane overhead. And we sat on the end of the catwalk, and there was the Ida and Joseph steaming up the harbor. It was like a show at 7:45 in the morning. Instantly, they dropped the net, made the circle. The vessel was loaded in the middle of Gloucester Harbor, probably 500 feet away from the Gloucester Byproducts Company where they would come land the fish.
That's this little sneaky thing I did. You know, I learned to be sneaky, but I'm working for that boat. The other boats are not paying me. At one time I did get paid, but five boats paid me. But it was too hard. They always think you're favoring. The best boat was the Ida. They thought I was favoring him. I didn't favor him. He caught more fish than the other boats.
When I watched the Ida and Joseph, every man knew his job and they went around that school of fish like clockwork. I said to myself, she's the best vessel in the fleet, and she was. No one could touch her. The captain was Sandy Calamo. He had a partner, my friend, Joe D'Amico. Joseph was in charge of the business affairs of the vessel. And because I insured the vessel, he became a very good friend of mine. When I insured vessels in the fleet, I insured the boat, but more importantly, I insured the owners. The character and the quality and the sincerity and the honesty of the owners, that was paramount. And my friend Joe D'Amico and Sandy Calamo, they were the best. And I can say this, in the 12 years that I insured the Ida and Joseph, we never had one claim from that vessel. My friend Joe Mello and I grew up together as kids. Joe and I were in the first grade together in the Hilda School. Like so many kids in those days, we gravitated to the Gloucester waterfront. His father was a fisherman before him, and he went fishing until he became an adult, and he found the longshoreman trade. I can't emphasize enough the value of stevedores, longshoremen, or as in we call in Gloucester, the lumper industry. Because without question, no fishing fleet as Gloucester was known for in 1945, the leading fleet in the world, we could not have functioned without the aid of the lumpers. Because when that vessel came in after 10 days, they would take out 250,000 pounds of redfish. The crew would go home. That was Monday. They hired a lumper, a stevedore, a vessel cargo handler, to work in their place. That gave them Monday off. Tuesday was day off for them. But on Wednesday morning or Wednesday afternoon early, that same vessel, the Kingfisher, the Benjamin C, or the Felicia, those vessels would take ice, grub, and fuel, and Wednesday afternoon, that vessel sailed for another 10-day trip. In the case of the pogie industry, all the seiners would come in the afternoon, and the lumpers that worked all day would now go over to the fish pier and start at 4 and 5 o'clock at night and work half the night till midnight, discharging pogies from that same boat, clean up the boat by 1 or 2 o'clock in the morning, and that boat at 5 o'clock in the morning would sail again for another day's fishing. They couldn't do that if the crew had to take out their own fish. So the lumpers were an essential
segment of the industry, an integral part.
It was good money, and so I stuck with the lumping. I lumped almost all the ships in the harbor. The Dutifully Rose was one of the biggest carriers in Gloucester. We would take out 350,000 pounds in a day, and all in a basket. Now, when we're in the hole, when you get 350,000 pounds, it calls for six men. I'd fill my basket and we'd go in turns. And you better have your basket ready, because you really take a rip and they start on you. What's the matter, kid? You can't do it, you know, and stuff like that. So I made sure that my basket was full. When that hook came down, I had to be ready. So it went around the six guys and it would just go around like that. And we'd have one mug up, and that's it. It was hard work. You get redfish bones in your hands and your head, stuck out of your head. There was always work there. Everybody would say, well, what is a lumper? The oldest man that was lumping at the time was Arthur Rose. And I said to Arthur, how did you ever come up with the name lumper? He said, well, years ago, they used pig iron to balance the ship. And he says, you got 5 cents per. So they called it a lump of iron and whatever they paid you. So it was lumper.
My friend Lou Nickel was the chief engineer on the Kingfisher. I said to Louis, I said, how can someone go 10 days at sea, have 2.5 days off, and then turn around and go another 10 days? How can somebody do this on a regular basis? Well, he said, that's what we did in those days. That's what we grew up with. That was our way of life. But, he said, you must understand that when I was building my house on Mount Pleasant Avenue, I was coming in every trip, and I was paying all the tradesmen off cash money when my friend, a local police officer, was making $35 a week, and I was sharing $400 and $500 for 10 days. So, yes, I had to sacrifice, and I didn't see my family, but I was also making 10 times more than what my contemporary friend of mine on the local police force was making. In Gloucester in 1945, our fleet was building, and so was the small boat fleet. Herman Melanson and his wife, they operated Melanson's boatyard of Parker Street. Melanson's men built numerous small vessels, mainly lobster boats, pent-up demand from World War II. They also built several inshore draggers. The largest of all was the Cigar Joe, Captain Joe Frontero. In the Montgomery shipyard, on the Annisquam River, they built the Immaculate Conception and the Rosemary V for the Vasque family. These were all inshore boats. And at Whalers Point Boatyard, Billy Ragusa had his vessel, the Francis R., built and launched at midnight under the floodlights of the fire department because there wasn't really enough water to launch the vessel. As far as the North Channel is concerned, they were mainly offshore fishing vessels. In the East Gloucester, Wanson Cove area, Bruce Shaw's fleet was located. There was also Cy Teisfer and his Edna Fay, and, of course, Captain Albert Arnold in the Phyllis A. Those were the prominent members of the Gilnet fleet. But the majority of the small boats were concentrated in Harbor Cove. It's really a sad state of affairs to drive down Angle Street on a Sunday morning, look down on Harbor Cove, and see it empty. In my day, in the 1940s, you could walk across Harbor Cove on the vessels moored here. They were rafted right straight across the harbor. And on St. Peter's Fiesta and the blessing of the fleet, Harbor Cove was plugged solid. The primary wharf in Harbor Cove was Ben Pine's old wharf, and that was taken over by an organization formed by 10 prominent inshore fishermen, and they renamed that wharf the Gloucester Whiting Association. It was a major part of the fisheries because, like redfish, whiting, silver hake was found in volume in Ipswich Bay and along the eastern seaboard. Gloucester Whiting Association vessels, people like Dominic Spinola, Captain Gus Sanfilippo, Tommy Aiello, Captain Testaverde, and these prominent fishermen were all banded together and they formed this association. By wartime, this was a mainstay in the fishing business in Gloucester. The whiting industry started in the 40s and continued right through into the 50s, when eventually it went offshore and the bigger vessels like the Joseph and Lucia II with the cutting machines and so forth were fishing in George's Banks for whiting fish. My friend, Accursio Gussie Belbo, was a crew member aboard the Vinci N with Captain Joe Novello and his crew. He eventually came back to the day boat fleet and bought his own vessel, the Hunter. Gussie and his son Danny operated the inshore vessel, engaged in the whiting industry. He was very successful. Anthony Palazzola, in his own vessel, the Mary Ann, started in small boats like the Novelty and broke in. Eventually he went offshore with the Santa Maria and the Pilgrim, and in turn, like so many other offshore fishermen, he came home to buy his own vessel, and he was a successful whiting fisherman himself. My friend Joe Gigoloni was a whiting fisherman. He also fished in the Natalie III as a captain, and the Gigoloni Scola families operated the St. Peter in the early 70s for almost a decade. And of course, Dominic Spinola in the St. Mary is legend. His three sons, Emilio, Michael, and Thomas, were also whiting fishermen. That's what they did. They thrived in the whiting industry, the small boats. They were a very important segment of the fishing industry in Gloucester. In 1902, young Salvatore Favazza found himself in the reception hall at Ellis Island in New York. He had $11 in his pocket, a train ticket to Detroit, Michigan, where he had a job waiting to work on the railway system out of Detroit. He saved his money, he sent money home to Terracini, Italy, and after a year or so, he married his childhood sweetheart, and in 1906, he returned to Gloucester. He went fishing, and he was successful. But he had an interest in St. Peter, the patron saint of the fishermen. So Salvatore went to the north end of Boston, and he commissioned a statue of St. Peter. Months later, the statue arrived in a crate. Next door, Peter Favazza owned and operated a grocery store, and he allowed them to put that statue in the window. Salvatore said that the Fiesta Committee can have that statue, but not until they have an appropriate place to display the statue, and that would be in the St. Peter's Club. That statue is being replaced this year, 2017, with a brand new fiberglass and so forth and so on. The big story here, as far as I'm concerned, is the success of Salvatore Favazza. In 1927, he launched his first vessel, the St. Peter, out of Essex, Massachusetts, built in the A.D. Story shipyard. He fished the vessel, and the family fished the vessel, until in 1945, during the redfish craze, the St. Peter II, a 95-foot vessel, was launched. That went with Captain Benjamin Favazza. It was followed by the fishing vessel St. Peter III. The original St. Peter was operated by Captain Joe Gigoloni and his partner, Sebastian Bikey Scola, and they operated it successfully in the 70s. The vessel was almost 50 years old. Sarah Favaza, the youngest child of Salvatore and his wife Mary, continues on the tradition of the St. Peter's Fiesta. In the Italian community, there were many, many leaders in the industry. First and foremost, you might say, is Benjamin Cukuru. He found his way to Gloucester, set nets in the middle of the Gloucester Harbor. He was the prime mover and organizer and president of Producers Fish Company, which was a leading outfitting wharf in the city of Gloucester at the time. The Benjamin C. is named after him. He was president of the Gloucester National Bank, and he was a director of the Addison Gilbert Hospital. My friends, the Novello family. That's a phenomenal story. They all turned out to be captains and boat owners and leaders in the industry. Joe Novello was considered an outstanding fisherman. My friend Dominic Novello was an insured of mine. He owned originally the JBN and then the Captain Scrod, and the family owned the vessel Barbara Jean. Dominic was probably the youngest of the family and certainly a bona fide highline fisherman in his day, as it was his boys, Jimmy and Dominic. At the peak of the redfish industry, there were a couple of fishermen that stood out above all, Captain Salvatore Sam Nicastro and his friend, Captain Joe Chamantaro. By the time he was 37 years old, Salvatore, in the brand new Felicia, was the captain of one of the biggest vessels in the fleet. The sister ship from the same yard, but a little bit smaller, was in the Benjamin C. They'd both leave together. But because the Felicia was a little larger, the Felicia would arrive before the Benjamin C. By the time the Benjamin C arrived, the Felicia was almost loaded. So the two vessels would fish together, and that when the Felicia was loaded, he would make another tow and pass the net over to the Benjamin C, and the two vessels would leave for home. They did this trip in and trip out. They had the best boats, the best equipment, and certainly the best crews. They just were highliners extraordinaire.
I was still in school, probably 14, 15 years old. And one day I was sitting in the kitchen and my father says, "You want to make a trip before you go back to school?" I says, "Yeah, I'll go with you, Dad. I'll go with you." We took off at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. And we steamed for 4 days and 4 nights just to get to the fishing grounds. That was off of Grand Banks. And as soon as we got outside the breakwater, I started getting sick. 4 or 5 days went by and I was still sick. The cook says, "Come over here, I'm gonna give you something to eat and I want you to eat it all the time." And it was bread and bananas. I'll never forget it. The more I ate, the more I threw up. Now we're too far, he can't bring me home. And then I would go to sleep because when you get seasick, you get drowsy, oozy, and the cook was cooking. And they were all smoking their cigarettes and the stink of the oil skins. The only time it was good was when we were catching fish. It was action, there was things going on, you know, things going on. I got home after 14 days of being sick. Never had a bath, I never had a bath for 14 days. Jumped in the tub, sat in the tub and the water was going back and forth, I was sick again. I think I was sick for about 4 or 5 days after that. And I told my father when I jumped off the boat, "Dad, I'll see you later. This is not for me."
Since I grew up and worked on the waterfront and derived my entire existence from working and participating in waterfront activities, I would say that the Brancaleone family, as I knew them, as I insured their vessels, and as I followed their careers over 5 decades, it's this Brancaleone family that is probably one of the most successful, if not the most successful family in the fishing business in the city of Gloucester. Thank you. Brancaleone family, starting with the patriarch Giuseppe Brancaleone, Captain Joe, who had four sons. Joe and his wife Lucia brought their family here from Terracini, Italy in 1938, one of the most successful immigrant families. He and so many others were the prosperity builders for the city of Gloucester. Captain Brancaleone started in 1944 as the sole owner of the Joseph and Lucia, built in the James Yard in Essex, Mass. At the end of World War II. As an offshore dragger, that was something new and different because many, many Italians operated inshore sailing vessels at the time. He was 50 years old when he gave the vessel to his four sons. Those four men were all captains and engineers and ran the vessels for decades. They were the experts in their business. Tom Linquata, he was only a spare time employee. He had fished one or two trips aboard the vessel. At Christmas time, Captain Brancaleone Sr. called Tom Linquata and asked that he come to his house, and he was getting a refund on the discounted oil bill that the vessel had for the two trips that he sailed in June or July of that year. That could have been forgotten, but that's just an example. They were known for fairness and honesty, and they were known for taking care of their crews. They were like extended family of the Brancaleones. My good friend, Captain Joe Gigoloni, sailed in the Brancaleone vessels, and he told me the Brancaleones were the epitome of fairness. He was aboard the brand new Joseph and Lucia II. They went aboard the vessel, and it was spick and span. Formica and the first class joinery work. It had a hot and cold running water shower. The facilities and the amenities of the vessel were just beyond belief. The last of the Brancaleones, my good friend Joseph, passed away just this year. That chapter has closed. But a new chapter has come forth, and that's Captain Tom's son, Sebastian Busty Brancaleone, and his two sons, and his wife, Betsy, in a small vessel, the Tina and Tom. Captain Busty is a recognized authority on the waterfront. People go to him to seek out his advice. He is a continuation of the Brancaleone legacy in the fleet today. My friend, Clifford Kiki Adams, I've known him a lifetime. We chummed around occasionally together in the urban renewal area, the Duncan Street Harbor Loop area, commonly referred to as by the kids of the era, down back. It was the neighborhood that was down back. And it was a cohesive neighborhood in and of itself. And everybody that lived in that neighborhood was involved in the industry. The backside of Main Street cut this community off from the city proper, if you will.
We all were kids from fishermen. That didn't go any farther than that, my experience as far as what else the world consisted of. It was something that we're all involved in, and we all learned what the fishing industry was. And that was it as far as we were concerned. We knew nothing else. The neighborhoods that I grew up in were tough. You used to see our gang comedies. Well, that's like how I grew up. There's a good neighborhood for kids that the only parents that they really saw was their mother. Their fathers were off the sea. Fishing weeks at a time, and then when they'd come home, your father was almost like a stranger. He'd come home and he'd be gone in 2-3 days. He'd be gone again for another 2-3 weeks. Some of the other families that I'm talking about, they were kids that hardly knew their fathers, and some of them knew them for a short time. They'd be gone to sea, but they never returned. They got lost overboard in the storm, boat capsized or went down. And some of those kids grew up without fathers because of that.
We kept things going when Dad was fishing. Dad used to go for 30 days at a trip. And sometimes he'd get home in 14 days. You never knew, you couldn't plan a heck of a lot because you didn't know when he was going to come in. Come in when the boat got full is when he came in. And he was very, very handy. Anything to do with the water. But to pound a nail into a garage door, he could never do it. But anything to do with the water, he's right there.
I'd do it all over again. It was a great place. It was a great lesson to me in humanity. Every one of them, from the housewives down, if you went home with one of your friends, you'd walk in and just like the mother would say, "Now you sit down here," she said, "when's the last time you have a good meal?"
Harbor Loop, that's a new name, that's a new term. Duncan Street was comprised of Water Street, Wharf Street, Ivy Court, and Locust Street. Those four streets. Wharf Street, of course, was around the periphery where Ben Pine's wharf was and led down to where John J. Burke's wharf was. From Wharf Street up, there was Water Street, and that's where Kiki Adams lived, and Ben Pine's building was at the intersection of Wharf and Water Street.
Maggie Wallace, the silver perch, I bet in maybe 100 square feet, there must have been 25 bar rooms. So you can imagine, if you see all these old movies, the square riggers and bar rooms all over the place, I lived that. Until as I got older, they started dropping off. And it's just like everything else was falling away. Gloucester was changing even then.
And when urban renewal came through, I can remember like it was yesterday, poor Maggie Mason, Margaret Mason, and her husband Albert. Margaret was evicted, like everybody else, the Ekborgs and the Majors and all these people were all evicted so they could tear down this neighborhood. And Margaret found herself living on Cleveland Street, which is in the guts of the city. And people often told me that she was almost in shock. Gloucester lost its identity when urban renewal came. We sacrificed our identity for parking lots and vacant lots. In my estimation, it was a terrible thing. From 1940 to 1955 was a phenomenal period in Gloucester. It will never be repeated. The end of the era came about 1954, when five of the most beautiful vessels in the city of Gloucester were sold to the Canadian interests. Newfoundland companies bought all five vessels, and they left within 2 weeks. And it was the beginning of the end, a signal that the industry was changing. Groton's flagship, the Mother Ann, the largest of all the vessels, was sold. The Felicia, Mary and Josephine, and the Benjamin C. were all sold. And Captain Frank Rose's Edith and Lillian, a beautiful vessel, all went with that group of vessels. The American fishermen saw the handwriting on the wall. The fish were going further and further away from Gloucester.
The trips used to be 8 and 10 days. Then they got 12 and 14 days. And they could see the fish were on the Grand Banks were depleting because there was like an armada of boats that used to go out there for these redfish. And they even had boats coming from Poland. They were coming from all over the world because the Grand Banks were so plentiful. Like my father said one day, he says, "Nice, 3 or 4 hours, we're in Labrador. What the hell are we doing here? You know, we've just gone too far." And they continued to do some ground fish, but the heart of the industry was the redfish. And that was depleting. It wasn't a life that they could sustain.
There was a market in Newfoundland for beautiful, big, huge carriers at the time. And our five vessels were available, so they were prime targets.
Men didn't want to go out. They didn't want to go out that long anymore. You know, they were out there in bad weather. They were out there in hurricanes. There was no place to go. They had to just ride them out. And they saw no future.
It was really the beginning of the downturn of the industry, as far as I was concerned. there were other benchmarks that came along that propelled the industry in a descending downturn over a period of 50-odd years to where we are today. And it can't come back. Why? For 100 different reasons. This industry cannot come back. Even if the fish were there, and they're not, the main reason is that the consumer has changed. People want beer-battered shrimp. They want lemon butter sole. They want microwavable products. Canned mackerel in a tin can won't cut it. We're living in a different age, and what we did in 1945 and 46 and 47, unheard of today. No family man would leave his wife and his family and the soccer games and the little league. No fisherman would go to 10 or 12 days to the Grand Banks and miss that family life. I have friends of mine that I have that I socialize to this day, and they tell me their whole life is gone when they went fishing. They missed their whole family, the growing up of their family by being aboard that vessel. I believe Gloucester will always be about fishing. Change is the only constant. Gloucester's intrepid fishermen are investing in new modern vessels, anticipating a diverse and promising future. Fishermen are on the front lines, adjusting to every change. We too must recognize and adjust to change. The fishing industry of the 40s and 50s is over. In recent years, companies have relocated to inland sites. Fish processing can be conducted anywhere. In the 1940s, Gloucester was the world's leading fishing port, utilizing only 50% of the 1930s depression-marred harbor front. Today, our inventory of vacant fallow waterfront land is substantially larger. It's time we seriously reconsider DPA waterfront restrictions and our own local marine industrial zoning. We've waited 60 years for marine laboratories and water acidification plants to no avail. We can no longer justify reserving large swaths of harbor frontage for a greatly diminished industry. The brightest economic advances on our harbor front are the Beauport Hotel and the Cruise Port Complex, both deeply embedded in a marine industrial zone. Our city planners must revisit and change our outdated harbor zoning. Gloucester's future depends on it. I've been here a lifetime. And like my friend Clifford Adams said, I'd do it all over again. And I really would. When I was growing up as a little boy, I saw the Gloucester waterfront as the Disneyland of the era. That was my playground. This is my home, and I want to see it prosper, and I know it can prosper. This waterfront can be the keystone to the whole existence of Gloucester in the future. It has to be developed. It has to move forward.